Hello and welcome to MC4 at Home. I'm Chris and serve here as the lead pastor, and we are delighted that you're spending more time with us here via this online option. We are gathered in the sanctuary. You're invited to join us. We remain under restrictions from our governor, but so far we still have room. And so if you're interested, please know that you're invited. But the majority of us remain here online. Thank you for your time and your trust. Let me walk you through a few things that are normal for us in terms of a service. First of all, if you're newer here, we would so value you letting us know that you're with us. We value connection, and in the age of COVID-19, connection is more challenging than ever. So would you go ahead and click that digital connect card that's on mc4s.org or our app? You can go to either one, fill out that connect card. That comes to us. We'll get back to you. We'll send you a note, send you an email, and just say thank you. And as you want connection, we want that too. Secondly, would you let us know how we can pray with you? We pray every week as a ministry staff, and we would love to stand with you in faith for God's care and mercy to be applied to your life and to those you love. Also, there's the opportunity for you to give. Thank you for your faithfulness. We view giving as part of our worship. That is our response to God. And so thank you for your faithfulness. Go ahead and click that digital option. And then there are happenings on our events page that you are going to want to check out. So please avail yourself by clicking the events button. Now, it's time for us to prepare our hearts for our ongoing response to God in worship. Pastor Sherry is going to lead us. Let's worship.
Well, good morning, church family. I want to call us to worship this morning by introducing a new song to us today. And it's on the occasion that I hear a song or a chorus or a line that just jumps out at me, and I instantly will think, this feels like a song we need to be singing in this season, or this feels like a chorus, this feels like an anthem that we need to be proclaiming in this time. And there's a line in this song that just felt so much like that. And the line is this: everything that exalts itself must fall underneath the power of our great God. And as I worshiped with this line over the past several weeks, that has become my anthem. And I just thought, wow, this is something the church needs to proclaim right now, especially as there are many things exalting themselves in this moment, many things politically, many things in our own opinions and ways toward others and where we think we're right. And Lord, anything that exalts itself must fall underneath the power of you. And this song is called There Is a Power. And so today as we sing this, we say, there is no other power than you, Lord. There is nothing else that is worthy of us putting our hope in, that is worthy of us putting our trust in, especially as we head into November 3rd as a nation. We just say, God, everything that exalts itself must fall underneath the power. I love Pastor Chris said it so well, that our allegiance to Jesus calls into question our allegiance to everything else. And so we come today just bowing before the Lord, saying, God, no matter what happens, our allegiance is to you. You are our King. You are where our hope is. You are where there is any source of life and power and goodness. And so I want us today in our worship to proclaim that very thing, and also just to rest in who God is, that He is the one seated on the throne. Part of what we get to do today in our worship is receive communion together. And so I read this week in a communion liturgy, and it says this: we come not because we ought, but because we may. We come to this table not because we are righteous, but because we are penitent. We come to this table not because we are strong, but because we are weak. And we come not because we are whole, but because we are broken. That is how we come today. Would you read with me this morning the communion creed as we just declare and speak out and remind ourselves why it is that we come to this table? Our time of communion is a celebration of memory and hope. Through it, we proclaim Jesus' real presence with us, the forgiveness offered to us through Christ's work on the cross, and the ongoing spiritual nourishment He provides us. We come to this communion table with gratitude, recognizing that it is a complete gift of grace rather than something we have earned through our own achievement. We acknowledge that the power in communion does not come from the bread and the cup, but from the Holy Spirit, who unites us with Christ through the celebration. And while this act of remembrance is deeply personal, we celebrate it as the gathered community of believers in love and in concern for one another. And we come in hope, believing that this bread and cup are a pledge and foretaste of the feast that is to come when His kingdom is fully revealed, and with unveiled faces we shall behold Him and reflect His glory. Amen. So today, as we go throughout our time of worship, you are free to take communion at any time, whether it's with your family or with yourself and the Lord in the comfort of your home. But I'm going to read this passage from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 25. And then at any point thereafter, as we get into worship and singing, please feel free to take communion. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." Amen. Amen. Let's worship.
There is a power, there is a presence holding all heaven, watching the earth, and it can part troubled waters, quench every thirst, heal what is broken, and break every curse. There is a power so overwhelming, all of creation bows to its name. It came to save every captive, cover every shame, keep every promise, and break every chain. Oh, there is power in this room, and all to move, for the light is breaking through, and everything that exalts itself must fall underneath the power of our great God. There is a power death cannot alter. There is a grave hell could not steal. It's here to change every outcome, lift every head, win every battle, and raise the dead. For the light is breaking through,
In the name of Jesus, there is power. In the name of Jesus, there is healing. In the name of Jesus, there is power. It's in the name, in the name, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, there.
The day. I shall not want, and I shall not want.
when I taste your goodness, I shall not want, I shall not want, I shall not want. Thank you. Jesus, as we physically taste the bread and the cup this morning, so we say, God, when we taste of your goodness, there is nothing else. There is nothing else that we should desire. There is nothing else that could be better or more satisfying. There is nothing else that could bring more hope or more provision or more security or more rest than you. So we thank you, God, as we remember what you have done for us, what you have accomplished for us by laying low, by giving up your life. That we too, Lord, we lay ourselves low. We bow our hearts before you. And we know that our hope is in you alone, Jesus. Thank you that you are good. Thank you that you are on the throne and that you have shown us what is good. You've shown us what is right. So Lord, help us to walk in your ways, Jesus. Open our hearts wide this morning. Give give us ears to hear what you are saying to us as we open your word this morning. We want to hear what you're saying to your church, Jesus. In your name, amen.
They did it. It is finished. Last night, my team won the World Series for the first time in 32 years. My wife has proclaimed today a national holiday. 24 years of marriage, she has suffered through my disappointments in October. Congratulations, Dodgers. Congratulations, Jennifer. You've made it this far with me. Oh, if my voice sounds a little rough this morning, it's because last night we were jumping around the living room, screaming exuberantly. So I'm in a very good mood this morning. I'm hopeful that will translate through the camera. But I'm having fun. This is a one-off. I don't anticipate preaching in a Dodgers hoodie every week here forward for the next year. Please know that. I just had to this morning. So, hey, go ahead and turn with me in your Bible. Let's turn serious here. Revelation chapter 16. We want to continue our teaching series entitled The End is Near, a study in the book of Revelation. And we specifically now move into a portion of our study covering Revelation chapters 16 through 19. With the address of power and politics via this section of Revelation. We begin this series within a series, if you will, with a teaching entitled Welcome to Babylon. Doesn't that sound rather menacing? Welcome to Babylon. Let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to be our teacher, and then we'll dive in. Abba, we bless you and your holy name. You are the Lord, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in loving kindness and faithfulness. Lord, we revel in who you are and what you've done. We exalt you, Jesus Christ, Son of God, Lamb upon the throne. And we thank you for your Holy Spirit among us, in us, leading us into all truth. So now, Spirit, breathe again upon the Word of God and write it on our hearts. We want to live your way in the earth and utilize today's study to further that for each of us. We trust you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. We get the title for this book of study from the very first verse of it. The revelation from, or as some translations have it, of Jesus Christ. Revelation is the Greek word apokalypto, and it's a compound word meaning to remove a cover from. It is, as we've been detailing, the pulling back of a curtain so that what is behind it can suddenly be seen. It's this breathtaking, like, I now suddenly see what I didn't see before. And where we define an apocalypse, according to the Oxford Dictionary, as literally the end of the world is defined by the book of Revelation, the Bible uses this apocalypse as an understanding of heavenly perspective, of what's really going on in the midst of earthly happenings. It's the pulling back of the curtain to freshly behold Jesus. What is this an apocalypse of? Jesus all over again. John is seeing Jesus and the fullness of his work all over again for himself and those he's writing to. And now we are recipients of this apocalypse as well. And thereby, we're having our own. Let's do a quick review. Revelation 1 introduces us to this prophetic letter that's also a vision. John's invited into it. And it's written by John to seven specific churches. Revelation 2 and 3 contain the specific words to these specific churches. And throughout these addresses of the churches, there's this Greek word nikeo. It's the Greek word of conquering or victory, that Jesus is promising these churches that they would conquer in and with him despite their current difficulties, challenges, points of struggle, and complacency, as he calls them out of it. So conquering, and then we get to Revelation 4 and 5, where John is invited further into his experience and vision as the throne room of heaven is open to him and he sees the one who is seated on the throne and the slaughtered Lamb of God, this great warrior prince, the slaughtered Lamb of God sitting on the throne with God. And surrounding that throne are angelic creatures, humans who bear the image of God and worship cannons ricocheting throughout the created order. And then we have the very complicated middle section of Revelation 6 through 16, which several weeks ago Pastor Trevor walked us through. And we see these cyclical moments of judgment, three sets of seven seals and trumpets and bowls and judgment being poured out upon the earth. And then last week we studied an episode within that middle section, Revelation chapter 12, the pivot, if you will, the very heartbeat of the messaging of Revelation, where we learned of this cosmic ancient story that we are in, this battle between God and Satan, God who's for us, Satan who stands against God and stands against all who love God. And we learn that Satan has been displaced from the throne room, but we, because of Jesus, we have been welcomed to the throne of grace that we may continue to receive mercy in our time of need. Now as we come, we approach Revelation 16. Charles Dickens' classic story, A Tale of Two Cities, opens with a series of contrasts. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. We had everything before us, we had nothing before us. We were all going direct to heaven, we were all going direct the other way. Dickens sets his story in London and Paris before and during the French Revolution. And we today in Revelation 16 have something of our own tale of two cities. Not in England or France, but rather identified as Babylon and the New Jerusalem. Specifically in Revelation 16, we hear John reference Babylon the Great, who plays an immense role in the message of the book of Revelation. And we want to investigate this theme today and for the rest of the month of November as we walk through Revelation 16 through 19. Then, come December, we're going to move our study into the tale of the other city and the theme attached to it. That is, the restoration and renewal of all things and the New Jerusalem in Revelation chapters 20 and 21. Now, of course, as we've been studying, we've seen a great deal of symbolism employed in the communication of John's apocalypse. Symbolism requires tremendous study on our part to extract as much meaning as we can, given that we are so long removed from the original context and the initial recipients of this prophetic letter. And while this can be sometimes taxing, we also want to acknowledge that it's quite evocative. Let me remind you that Revelation was written that the reader might feel it. Things could be stated rather plainly and be forgettable, or they can be poetically depicted, powerfully apocalyptically depicted, and forever remembered because of the emotional impact the words produced. Think of the Tale of Two Cities, its impact, its remembrance. In similar fashion, Revelation is written to be felt and to be remembered. This symbolism continues to be true as we turn our attention to Babylon today. John clearly uses this ancient city and nation as a symbol of something much bigger and applicable across the ages. I want to show you four specific references in the book of Revelation in which Babylon is consistently addressed. The first we find is in Revelation chapter 14, verse 8, which reads, "A second angel followed and said, 'Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great.'" Now notice the quotes around "fallen, fallen, Babylon the Great." This is a direct quote from Isaiah chapter 21. And that begs us to ask the question, why is Isaiah, some 700 years prior to the time of Jesus, why is Isaiah talking about Babylon? More on that in a minute. "A second angel followed and said, 'Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great, which made all the nations drink the maddening wine of her adulteries.'" Then let's look at Revelation chapter 16, our text of study today. "The great city split into three parts, and the cities of the nations collapsed. God remembered Babylon the Great and gave her the cup filled with the wine of the fury of his wrath." Revelation 17. "The name written on her forehead was a mystery. Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes and of the abominations of the earth." And then finally again, Revelation 18. "With a mighty voice, he shouted, 'Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great.'" Isaiah chapter 21 again. "She has become a dwelling for demons and a haunt for every impure spirit, a haunt for every unclean bird, a haunt for every unclean and detestable animal." So clearly, Babylon is not a place we want to end up, nor is it something we want to participate in. To understand more, let's go back to the start of our scriptures and the first mention of Babylon, which then sets the course for its use both literally and metaphorically. So all the way back in Genesis 10, we learned that the city of Babel, aka Babylon, was founded by Nimrod, which is Hebrew, and it is a name from which is derived of a verbal form, and it means to rebel. Nimrod means to rebel. So his name was based on his character. His name captured his arrogance and his character, which is proven to be true of the population of this entire city following him. In fact, in Genesis 11, we read of the people conspiring to make a name for themselves over and against the name of God. As God saw through this, as he saw the thoroughness of their rebellion and the evil it propagated. He stepped in and he frustrated the happenings by suddenly introducing different languages. As a result, we read in Genesis 11, 8, and 9, "So the Lord scattered them from there all over the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole earth. From there, the Lord scattered them over the face of the whole earth." Babel is known for the separation of peoples. From here forward, Babylon becomes symbolic of human arrogance and opposition to God, and is the antithesis of the sort of place and people that God desires for his presence and glory on the earth. Hint, hint, preview, the New Jerusalem is exactly what God desires. Babylon is the exact opposite of what God desires. So Babylon also becomes a literal city and nation. Of course, we read in Genesis 10 of the founding of Babel. But later, this becomes the very nation that God utilizes to bring judgment on unfaithful Judah. In fact, let me show you here on the map, because a good sermon always needs a map. So you'll see this extensive Babylonian empire. And here we actually have the capital city of Babylon. Babylon, it's not very close, actually, to the southern kingdom of Judah and the epicenter of that, Jerusalem, where the temple was. But they were rampaging this entire area. Eventually, Babylon would give way to the Medes and the Persians. But before they did so, Babylon brutalized the people of God. The Hebrew scriptures tell us of how they came to Jerusalem, absolutely ransacked and destroyed the city, absolutely destroyed the temple, carried a majority of the people off into exile that they didn't kill and brutalize. And in fact, they took some of the best and brightest of the young people of Judah and put them in the king's courts. Ever heard of people like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Those are Babylonian names, by the way. They renamed them and they sought to inculcate them with Babylonian culture. What they wanted to do was they wanted to eradicate the ways of God, the ways given the people of Israel by God himself, and make them Babylonian, not only in name, but in culture and values. This is Babylon, literal and metaphorical. Some of you may recall Psalm 137, 1 through 3, which captures a moment of these exiles of Judah in Babylon and their experience therein. "By the rivers of Babylon," the psalmist wrote, "we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. There on the poplars we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy. They said, 'Sing us one of the songs of Zion.'" So we clearly understand contextually that Babylon mocks and intimidates, even as it seeks to replace life with God and God's ways. And do you feel like this dynamic is a little bit at play even today? Yeah. You see how Babylon literally also becomes something much bigger metaphorically. And that is how John is using it in his communication with those receiving this prophetic letter. One more point of reference from the Hebrew scriptures. Listen to the words of the king of Babylon, King Nebuchadnezzar, as recorded in the book of Daniel 4, verse 30. "Is not this the great Babylon I have built as the royal residence by my mighty power and for the glory of my majesty?" Arrogance, human defiance of God, my way over God's way. Babylon. Okay, with all this as a background, let's turn our attention now to Revelation chapter 16 as we commence walking through Revelation's address and use of Babylon. Revelation 16 opens with John hearing a loud voice saying to seven angels, go, pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth. Remember that this middle section of Revelation, chapter 6 through 16, is one in which we see three cyclical expressions of judgment. Seven seals, seven trumpets, and now seven bowls. The first two cycles of seals and trumpets, they have a great deal in common with one another, and they also have a great deal in common with the plagues poured out on Egypt recorded in the book of Exodus. Of course, these were poured out due to Egypt's enslavement of Israel and the murder of its innocent children. As verse 16 unveils now the bowl judgments, we see a significant change here. Where there was an invitation to repentance within the first two cycles, even in the midst of judgment, there was the invitation by God to repentance. But now here in the bowl judgments, the final expression of judgment, that invitation to repentance fades from view. It is a way in which we see that these bowl judgments bring to completion this age that we know right now and will be the final piece to then allow for the commencement of the age to come. There is, without question, a thoroughness about these bowl judgments that was only partial in the judgments of the seals and the trumpets. In Revelation chapter 16, verse 15, following the description of demonic spirits active in the nations of the world to foster a unified deception and opposition to the Lamb and those who follow the Lamb, Jesus proclaims, look, I come like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake and remains clothed so as to not go naked and be shamefully exposed. So in the midst of the nation's tumult, Jesus speaks again to his own. And he says, I'm returning. I am coming back. As you wait, do not lose heart. So remain vigilant in your stand against deception and the distortions you're facing of grace and truth. Remain vigilant in your first love of me. Remain vigilant in your allegiance to me. He warns profoundly against complacency leading to compromise within his people. And that gets us to the verses we want to study today, Revelation 16, verses 17 through 21. Revelation 16, let's begin in verse 17. The seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and out of the temple came a loud voice from the throne saying, it is done. The final bowl is poured out into the air, which strikes us as a curious description. But the air was known in Greek and Roman mythology as the lowest level of the heavens. And in the New Testament, it refers to the spiritual realm as it affects our lives and the world. So the spiritual realm that is as real as anything we can tangibly hold on to. It's likely a way of asserting here again God's ongoing sovereignty over the entire cosmos, the physical and spiritual worlds. And with this bowl, the judgments are done. God has accomplished his purposes and plan. He has established his kingdom and completed his wrath. And whenever we see a mention of God's wrath in the scriptures, I think for many of us, we don't know what to do with it. But let me remind you, O follower of Jesus, follower of the Lamb, that God's wrath has been dealt with for you and me in the cross of Jesus Christ. God's wrath has been addressed for all who run to the shelter of the name of Jesus. God has allowed his Son to carry our sin and rebellion, our arrogance and shame. For those who refuse his provision, a day of judgment awaits. Revelation proclaims very clearly that a day of judgment is coming. Verse 18. Then there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, and a severe earthquake. No earthquake like it has ever occurred since mankind has been on earth. So tremendous was the quake. So this again is a reference to the appearance of God at Sinai in Exodus, where he established covenant with Israel. In fact, it's the fourth reference in the book of Revelation to God at Sinai. And with each one, there's an increasing intensity. Here again, John is describing a finality about this judgment. It's also interesting for us to stop and note that four of the seven churches mentioned in Revelation chapters 2 and 3 experienced destruction due to earthquakes according to historical record. So they would understand the power being referenced here, the idea of destruction attached. Let's go to verse 19. The great city split into three parts, and the cities of the nations collapsed. God remembered Babylon the Great and gave her the cup filled with the wine of the fury of his wrath. The great city, Babylon the Great, here signifies Rome. Yeah. So he's utilizing this arrogant, rebellious to God. We will do things our way. We will exalt ourselves as God. Caesar, the imperial cult, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as he's described on a coin. Those who arrogantly oppose God and his ways. Babylon, an ancient enemy, is metaphorically used right now in this letter to address the recipients of this letter, and John is addressing Rome. And here, in what John sees, it is utterly destroyed, as are the cities of the nations who collude with Rome. The note of God remembering here is a metaphor for his enacting of justice in this moment. This is a moment of God acting in his justice. Let's keep going. There's a little bit more here. Verse 20, and then we'll finish with 21. Every island fled away, and the mountains could not be found. From the sky, huge hailstones, each weighing about 100 pounds, fell on people, and they cursed God on account of the plague of hail, because the plague was so terrible. The islands here signify the farthest reaches of the earth, and the mountains being the high places that once were focused spots of idolatrous worship, now being brought low, being made plain for the way of the true King of heaven and earth, the true Lord of Lords, the slaughtered Lamb, Jesus the Christ. And hailstones were widely understood at the time of the writing as divine judgment, reminiscent of the seventh Exodus plague in the book of Exodus. The ridiculous size of these is used as a proverbial image of fullness and finality. 100 pounds. Those opposed to God, as this chapter closes, remain opposed to him. So there's a lot happening here. And of course, we're now entering into a section of the book that is very sobering. Very sobering. Welcome to Babylon. Let's go ahead and look at three points of application for us. Welcome to Babylon. Number one, a final judgment is coming. A final judgment is coming. Listen to scholar Bruce Metzger in his work Breaking the Code of Babylon, as it is used in Revelation based on the Hebrew scriptures. Babylon is allegorical of the idolatry that any nation commits when it elevates material abundance, military powers, and prowess technological sophistication, imperial grandeur, racial pride, and any other glorification of the creature over the creator. The message of the book of Revelation concerns God's judgments, not only of persons, but also of nations, and in fact, of all principalities and powers, which is to say all authorities, corporations, institutions, structures, bureaucracies, and the like. All places and spaces, nations and cities, and peoples opposed to the enthroned Lamb of God will be judged. Nothing and no one will be left unaddressed. And in the midst of this, Revelation is a cry for God's people to remain vibrantly faithful to the enthroned Lamb. For their vindication and reward is surely ahead. Do not give up the hope you have. This is part of the messaging of Revelation. Hold on. But as those who are called upon to remain vibrantly faithful, it's not just that their vindication is ahead. It's also that God's heart longs to reach others by those he's already reached. They are those who hold out. We are those who hold out the message of life for others to consider joining us in repentance. Did you hear earlier in the teaching the note that in the first two cycles of judgment, repentance remains offered? But in this last moment of judgment, this finality of judgment, in the conclusion, when the end comes, that offer is not present any longer. We are those who presently hold out the word of life that others could join us in the consideration of it, to turn from our own dead-end, wicked, rebellious ways to behold the God of rescue, to join the God of rescue in his way in the earth. Welcome to Babylon. A final judgment is coming. Babylon demands it. Secondly, God's judgment is a reflection of his justice. John insists that this scene and what follows is not gleeful vindictiveness on God's part or his heart, but is rather a reflection of his justice. Even to the very end, God holds out the free offer of repentance to any and all who would receive the gift of life. Allow me to share a quote from C.S. Lewis, who reflected on this truth in his classic work, The Great Divorce, in which he wrote, "There are only two kinds of people in the end, those who say to God, 'Thy will be done,' and those to whom God says in the end, 'Thy will be done.' All that are in hell choose it. Without that self-choice, there could be no hell. No soul that seriously and constantly desires joy will ever miss it. Those who seek, find. Those who knock, it is opened." In light of this, consider with me again the beauty and grace of Jesus for all who run to the shelter of his name. God has found it just that his Son would carry every wrong I've committed to the cross, that I now would have access to his throne of grace, that I would now have access to mercy at every point of need that I have. He is committed to making us a people marked in an inheritance. He is committed to making us a people who are being made worthy of the calling we've received in the Son Jesus. And I want you to hear this. In this way, God's judgment has already begun with us. We are already in the process of judgment, and God's wrath is satiated. His Son has attended to all of our evil. Now then, let us run our race with conviction, and let us run our race with vibrant faithfulness until the very end. This is the message for the people of God in Revelation. And it's packaged in a way where when you know the end of the story, you can run the race differently. My wife and I were reflecting on this last night as we rewatched Game 6 of the World Series. We were pacing the living room last night. I could hardly sit down. When you don't know the outcome, nerves, adrenaline, your stomach's churning, you're sick to your stomach. But when you know the ending, well, I'll tell you, I was sitting there laying on my couch, delighting in every moment of rewatching the game. When you know the end of the story, the way in which you participate in it changes. We know the end of the story. No matter what we face at present, we know the end of this story. Let us run our race as those who have received such grace and kindness in Jesus, and let us run all the way to the end. Welcome to Babylon. A final judgment is coming. Secondly, God's judgment is a reflection of his justice. And thirdly, God's people are to stay alert and vigilant as we await to the end. Revelation 16 has the words of Jesus, "Behold, I come like a thief," which is to say that we do not know when he will come. The stage is set, my friends, but we do not know when he will come. That acknowledged, we are to live today. We are to live right now in a way so as to not be surprised when he does appear. Let us not be those who spend their salvation years and story on shameful living, as those stepping out of the provisions of God made ready for us in Jesus. But instead, let us be those who fulfill the words of the Apostle Paul, and I offer this to you in conclusion, the words of Paul in Philippians 2, verses 12 through 16. "Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Do everything without grumbling or arguing." Take that in right now. "Do everything without grumbling or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then, now, you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life. And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain." Revelation challenges us to ask the question in our moment: are we living this moment of a pandemic and of great political divide in such a way that our way stands in stark contrast to the way of our culture, to the way of Babylon? Does our way as citizens of the kingdom of heaven look different than the way of our culture? If the answer isn't a resounding yes, let us come before the throne of grace in repentance and ask our Savior to shape us all that much more and all over again by the power and person of the Holy Spirit and through the transformative nature of the Word of God. Let's pray. Abba, we do submit ourselves to you, and as we commence this new section of study in the book of Revelation, we do require the aid of your Spirit. So Holy Spirit, we just stop and ask that you would be poured out upon your people again. Holy Spirit, be poured out upon us. And we ask, Lord, that you would cause us to be those who heed the words of our Savior, who stand ready, attentive in our faith, be being shaped by your Spirit, our character reflecting our Savior. And that you would be calling us out of the ways in which our culture, the ways in which arrogant Babylon has shaped us more than you have. God, every one of us, Lord, we're just all honest. Myself, every one of us. Babylon has impacted us in various ways. Impacted the way we think, impacted points of character. And yet we know that you've called us out of Babylon into the kingdom of the Son you love. And so we ask that today you would illumine more and you would show us your way that much more. And Spirit, help us to walk in the way of Jesus. Thank you for that, God. Lord, we just take a moment. And as November opens, a month of Thanksgiving, thank you. Thank you for the cross, Jesus. Thank you that you have taken on our judgment for the evil we've participated in. Thank you for the cross, Jesus. Thank you for making us recipients of grace. Thank you for qualifying us as ready-made mercy recipients. We love you, God, and we thank you for all of this. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Love you. Thank you for time together here via MC4 at home. Dodgers, they did it. Yes. But all that much more, Jesus has done it. How great is the salvation we participate in. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus our Lord. We'll see you soon.